Thanks for being here virtually. And so we're going to go from India to South America and try to understand these new financial tools that the market has to address underserved clients. So in developing countries, there's a large population that is either unbanked or has limited access to loans. And the banks that wish to expand their lending portfolio to these new clients are usually very limited in using traditional scoring methods because these individuals have limited financial interaction, so they don't have a credit history, and their income is very often very difficult to measure. So there's a bunch of new technologies that have multiplied around that have allowed banks and other financial institutions to use alternative screening mechanisms for individuals that are unbanked. I will be looking at probably one of the simplest of these versions and ask what are the consequences of expanding your loan portfolio to through that mechanism. So, you know, there's the typical thing, more credit is better, that would be the neoclassical view. But if individuals are facing behavioral restraints, they might not even know that they shouldn't be getting into debt. So we'll try to study this. And then on a related note, what we're gonna try to ask is, does it matter who these individuals are? So basically there are two types of individuals who are excluded from the formal market. There are people who are coming back because they did bad stuff in the credit market and now they want to obtain a new loan. Or there are newcomers. There are people who have never interacted with the credit market and will do some interactions based on that. So given the time of the presentation, I'm not gonna have a lot of time to discuss the literature, but basically there's mixed results on this study when we look at RCTs in general. The two papers that are probably the most similar to us, so Dean Carlin and co-authors have a RCT on credit builder loan, but this is in the US where the credit market is much more working, credit scoring is also much more sophisticated. And then there's this paper by Arais and others in Peru that use behavioral tests to give as a mechanism to grant loans. And they show a lot of problems for the bank who did that because of adverse selection. We will show that our credit product is much more preferred than theirs. So we won't have problems with people refusing the loan once they get it. You know, a large fraction of all types of clients will take this loan. So what is the loan we're talking about? This was a product made for the unbanked. So if you look at the publicity, Dustin was talking about YouTube being our presentation, so you can actually go find the publicity on YouTube for this loan. They were basically targeting nannies, construction workers, you know, the person who sells fruits and veggies in the market. They wanted to try to attract people who were from the informal sector. I said that this was maybe an old generation of these algorithm base. So it is using demographics and other types of information that are, so this is not using your Facebook history or any of that stuff that is now popping up as alternative. The applicants needed to go to a bank and show their national ID card, which is called a cédula in English. So this was called crédit cédula for that reason. The decision was entirely made by the algorithm. So the bank officer had no capacity to change anything. A number came out and it said, you're in or you're out. It took about less than 20 minutes. And what type of loans are we talking about? about $450. That was the maximum 1 year term, and the rates are around 40%. So this is a costly loan for people who don't have much access to alternative. The product was launched in 2012, and by 2013, they figured out that they could pair this with an app on the phone. So now you didn't need to go to the bank, you needed to basically scan your national ID on a phone. So what is kind of interesting is that this algorithm base score does not at all resemble the predictions that the national authority of credit score did. So on the vertical axis, we have Equifax, the credit bureau, and then on the horizontal axis, we have what they predicted, and you see that there's basically no correlation. So they were somehow able to exploit data that the credit authority was not able to. So how are you gonna measure the impact of this policy? We're gonna use administrative data from the bank, that is our partner bank, and from that credit bureau. So from our partner bank, we're going to know when they apply to the loan, whether the loan was given, what was the credit score in Equifax at the moment that the person applied, because they asked for it, even if they didn't use it, and then exactly the score, the algorithm that they obtained. And then what we did is in March 2017, we went in from a terminal from our partner bank and asked for the credit history of the individuals that were around the cutoff. Because of time and money restrictions, we basically only looked at the people who were very, very close to the cutoff. So this is going to be a very, very narrow RD. All the requests, what are we going to get from that? We're going to get all the requests made by financial institutions to the credit bureau. So if someone wants to know about Dustin, they have to go and ask the credit bureau. We're going to know that this institution made a request. Now, this has a cost because we do not have the actual loans. So we know that this bank tried to know something about you, but we don't know for sure that you did get loans, and I'll come back to that. And then we also have the negatives. So we also have every debt that was reported to the credit bureau as unpaid, as late, how much you were late, and what was the amount that was pending. And then finally, we know your ex-post credit score. What was your credit score in March 2017? So this is kind of what we have as a data. So these were coming out in PDF, and we had to all digitalize them, okay? So what are we going to do? We're going to recenter a little bit. Priya was talking about difference in discontinuity. So we're going to recenter all the data around the visit to Credit Cedula. So you shouldn't be affected before, but you should be affected after you visit. And given that people have different windows, we're going to normalize by 100 days to make that comparison acceptable between individuals. And we also tried to get a survey, but we had a really hard time getting people. So I'll show you in the best case scenario, we have 82 people in our sample for the survey. So this is not gonna be great once you put an ID on it. I told you that we have this issue that we only know if the bank or the financial institution asks to the credit bureau anything about you. But in our survey data, we're able to contrast these two records, and we're able to show that having more requests to Equifax in the credit bureau is highly correlated with requesting credit and being awarded a loan in the formal sector. So it's not perfect data, but it seems to be capturing something that we care about. So we're going to do an RD since we have the cutoff, so we know exactly when the algorithm gave you the loan and when it didn't. But unfortunately, the score was not continuous. It was rounded to third decimal. So given that we went around 0.04 of the score, this basically means we have 8 data points on the horizontal axis, and doing an RD with, you know, complicated polynomials is not going to get us very far, because we only have these 8 width. And we're not going to ask data to pick the optimal bandwidth, because we did that based on costs starting. But we're going to try to replicate a non-parametric specification as close as we can. So we're going to use kernel weights, triangular kernel weights. We're going to put more weight at the center of the distribution. And we're going to use the type of polynomial approximation that have been used in this case. Okay. So the first thing I need to convince you is that we don't have manipulation around the cutoff. So we cannot reject the McCrory test. If the cutoff was one step on the left, I would be able to. So this tells us that maybe people had a little bit of a sense of what was, whether they were going to get in or not, but they were not able to predict it perfectly. We also have information if we go for the later part of the sample, people, the credit loan officers were entering more of the rejection, while at the beginning they just didn't have time, so they were not entering the people at the right who were not getting the loan. So another thing I should convince you of is that these individuals before they showed up to get the loan are identical. So this is this table. I'm showing you that before they went to the bank, they were not more likely to have requests in Equifax, not from this bank, Banco Familia, or from other banks. We can do it in non-parametric, in linear, and they also didn't have a different credit score. So what happened once they showed up to the bank? So this is our first stage. The people who have a low probability of default predicted by the algorithm are more likely to take the loan. This is about 40% more likely. And once we look at characteristics, we're finding that there's not much difference between who took the loan based on different characteristics of these individuals. So that's why I was saying this seems to be a popular product, not like the case in Peru where most people actually turned down. What happened to their credit history or their interactions with the credit system after Credit Cedula? So again, I'm showing you the graphs, and you're seeing that the people who are on the left who are eligible for the loan interacted a lot more with the credit market after they were eligible for this loan. We excluded the days right around the cutoff because people may do shopping. So this is not because, and I'll show you, because they got loans right after. This is something that's quite long lasting. And we can do that in a variety of ways and find always around 0.5 requests per 100 days increase. And this is a relatively big number because for the control group, you were about 0.8. So a 0.5 increase is a large increase. Does it last? Yes, it lasts. So the impact was around 0.5, 0.6 for the full period. But if you look at within 100 days and within the first year, you're something like 0.8. But even after the year after they visited Credisola, they get something like 0.5 for the subsequent. And this is not just because our partner bank looks at them nicely because they got this. So yes, there are more requests from Banco Familia, but there are also a lot more requests from finance companies, which are basically the next tier below banks in Paraguay, and cooperatives. We also see a short-term impact on store credits, so they're more able to go to the superstore and obtain a loan for an electronic or something of that sort. And surprisingly, money lenders provide information to the credit bureau in Paraguay, and we see a small increase, but much smaller. So this seems to suggest that they are more integrated with the financial market and in better institutions. So in about the 3 minutes I have left, I can show you that they don't have much of an impact on their unpaid debts. So they get more financially integrated, but we're not seeing, at least in the whole period, that they are more indebted to the credit system. So that sounds like a good news. However, their credit score worsens. And part of this might be just automatic. You know that in the US, if you ask for a loan, your credit score will fall. We're told that this is not quite the same in Paraguay. But in some sense, we do see that some of them got worse. And then when we look at our self-reported outcomes, that I told you we had a very, very small sample, we see positive results. So they spend less on credit. They're less likely to have trouble paying their bills. And they're also reporting better financial well-being. But, you know, this is a small sample. I'm not sure we can make much out of it. Now, what we think is more important is looking at the heterogeneity. So what we're seeing in the following tables is that the people who benefited from this interaction are people who were less well known by the financial system. So, for those who had already a lot of interaction, we don't see an increase in their interaction. For those that had really good credit scores, we also see less of an impact than those that had bad credit scores. And this is not reflecting differences in income or formality. And the same thing happens when we look at the debt. So people who were well known by the financial sector and got this loan thanks to the algorithm ended up with more debt. But the people who were less well known, actually we see no impact or even potentially a better impact on their debt. They're less likely to have problems repaying their debt thanks to this door opening to them. And the same pattern for the credit score, they don't worsen their credit scores that badly when they were less well known. So in conclusion, we feel that we are able, thanks to this Partners Bank craziness, to estimate the causal impact of becoming loan eligible in an algorithm-based mechanism. And overall, we find a positive impact with increased financial integration, particularly in formal sources, limited impact on defaults, positive self-reported benefits. And this was a profitable product for the bank at 40%. If we go way lower, that does not become the same. But that there's also some nice heterogeneity. So we argue that this suggests that new screening methods that are roaming around can be used for excluded populations with success, but that it might be even better for these institutions to combine it with some sort of information regarding how much experience these clients have on the credit. That's it.
Great. Thanks, Jeanne. So I wanted to, before I go to the panelists, we want to try something out with the attendees. If you could try just saying hello in the chat box down below and sending it to all panelists and attendees, that would be great. We wanna see the functionality here and get some comments there. And then also, of course, the Q&A is there as well if you have questions for Jeanne. But in the meantime, Priya, Luciana, Georgia, do you have any questions, comments?
Do you think that the presence of people reporting prices might have affected the revenue that the sellers got?
Luciana, go for it.
Just one little question. So you do say that in terms of heterogeneity, those that are new or that haven't had interactions before are the ones that benefit the most. Do you know if that's a result of the targeting, the advertising that the bank did to target this this population, or do you imagine any other mechanism going going on there?
Yeah, so that's an excellent question. Let me actually reshare my screen so that I can answer you a little bit. So if you look at the take up of the loan based on how much interaction they had in the credit market, you don't see a difference. So I can't say that there were more or less people arriving with these characteristics, but what I can say is that they were equally happy to get this loan offer, or unhappy if you want, 40%. And so I do not think that the results are selection based, clearly there was an effort. I think this is, you know, the message is that a bank that wants to reach these people can do it, and can do it in a profitable way by developing some sort of innovative screening method.
Thank you.